it's cold in this camper van when it's not moving around. In this video, I want to accomplish two things. Number one, give you a 2-minute tour of the van, including how this sofa folds down into a bed and I sleep like a baby. And number two, I want to give you 3 tips on how I deal with things like not being able to have babies, even though my husband and I tried for a few years. So the reason I'm sharing these 3 tips on how to deal with broken dreams or disappointment in life or disappointment with God are because of 2 reader comments that I got. One was on a blog post and one was in an email. And the first one, she said, I read your About Me page and I see all of your broken dreams and disappointments. I'm wondering how you moved past it. How did you ever see God as good? And how did you learn to trust Him again? And the second reader sent me an email. She said, I noticed that you have chosen to live your best life even though you aren't able to have children. I'm just curious how you shifted your brain from your heart's desire and what you thought God had for your life. So I'm going to give you 2 kind of practical ways that I have moved forward and 1 more spiritual, more divine or God-oriented way. The first thing is going to be the lightest, most sort of surficial or superficial. And that's learning how to listen to what comes to you and follow it. Oh. This is my coaster that I'm using as a bookmark. And this is my journal. I was on the ferry about 1.5 weeks ago and I was printing. I usually write in print in my journals. And then I started writing in cursive for some reason while I'm on the ferry to Vancouver Island. And I was noticing that I really liked it, but it was super messy and it was really uncomfortable and hard to do. This is a weird example of a very little way to move on after you're disappointed. Pointed with life is when something comes with you, follow it. Something comes to you, just go with it and see where it might lead. The second example of something coming to me and me following it, even though it didn't make any sense and I didn't really understand it, was this camper van. So I've been wanting to buy one for years, like maybe 4 or 5 years. And about 1 year ago, after my father-in-law died, I realized I have to do it now. It just really came to me strongly that I have to do it now because life is short. And if I don't do it now, I don't know when I'm going to do it. And that wasn't as easy as learning how to write in cursive or practicing writing in cursive, because this is the second biggest investment I've ever made. And I've never owned a camper van before. I had no idea that you could fold down beds and sleep in the back. I had no idea that this has a heater and it's got lights and USB ports. I had no idea about any of it, but it came to me to get this camper van. So when you are coping with the disappointment or you feel like God has let you down in some way, pay attention to what's coming to you now. After, of course, you grieve. It's really important to grieve your losses. I'm 50 now, and I was about 43 or 44 when I realized it's it. Like, I'm not going to have kids, and I just have to let that go. And as the years progressed, I was able to be freer and freer from the grief. And now I will look at a baby and be like, that is so cute, and my heart does respond, but I don't feel really sad or heartbroken. To tell you the truth, a lot of me is kind of glad that I don't have kids because I do feel freer and more financially free than I would be if I had have kids. And when we first found out that I couldn't, that we couldn't have children, I wondered if God was maybe protecting me from something or if there was something that I was being saved from. For instance, my mom has schizophrenia. And I was never diagnosed with it, and I have never had a mental illness or an emotional health illness. But I wondered if perhaps if we had had children, if maybe my kid would have had schizophrenia. I have no idea, but those things automatically occurred to me when I first found out we couldn't have kids. So that's another kind of an extra tip for dealing with disappointment with life or when God doesn't give you the desires of your heart. Consider that you may be saved from something that you don't even know, that you may never be aware of. So the second tip that I have for dealing with disappointments is holding fast to those things that come to you. I've noticed looking over the past 50 years of my life that I tend to say things. I'll speak my truth and I may know my truth, but I don't hold it and I don't defend it or work towards it. I let myself be swayed. I listen to culture. I listen to people and I don't really push for what I really believe in. And that relates to the cursive writing as well. And I can see the literal growth and progression of something good when you hold it. For instance, the writing was really bad. When I was learning over the past 10 days to write cursive, I write in a different color every day. I can see literally it getting better and better. The writing is getting more and more beautiful, my cursive letters, because I'm holding fast to what I want. So when something comes to you, whether it's, I want to learn how to write in cursive or paint letters or buy a camper van or save up for some major life adventure, hold it and work through the initial tough stages, because it's going to be hard. Whether you're grieving something, whether you're excited about something, whether you're writing a book, which is what I'm doing now, you've got to work through those initial tough stages while you're holding it, and know and trust and have faith that you will have some sort of fruit at the end. And it may not be what you expect. God may not give you the desires of your heart, but you will find something that you didn't anticipate, and it'll be good. My third tip for coping with disappointment in life or disappointment in God because He didn't give you the desires of your heart is not to take it so personally. I actually don't know if God has a specific plan for my life. I believe that life unfolds in some certain way, and there's all these things that are happening that don't have anything to do with us. And that's what I mean by not taking it personally. So if you can't have children, or if you lost someone you love, or if you're going through a divorce, there may be things happening that don't have anything to do with you. It may not be personal. If you believe in God and you believe that He's organizing the universe in a certain way, then you have to believe that you not getting something is all part of the big plan and the big picture. Or for me, God is like living within me. It's the divine spirit that we have this relationship and we're walking forward together. So it's not that God did not grant me the desires of my heart. It's that this thing happened. I could not have children, and instead other things are coming to me, and I'm walking into them wholeheartedly and with great excitement and joy. So those are just three ways that I cope with disappointment in life or disappointment when God doesn't give me the desires of my heart. I hope they've helped you. I hope you stick around for the next couple minutes while I show you a little bit of Ruby. And above all, I hope you take good care of yourself, because you are worth taking good care of. Mwah! It is freezing in here. I could turn on the heater, but I was like, no, I don't want to waste propane just for a little video. And now I am frozen. Oh, it's a whiteout. I'm just kidding. We're not actually on a trip right now. This is the tarp that Ruby is stored underneath. There's part of our house. And then I just wanted to give you a little introduction to the camper van. This is the back area, and I guess we'll just keep going in a little bit. This is the clock that I got at the dollar store, and then I painted. It didn't come all rainbowy. That's the camper van that I got in Haiti several years ago, maybe 5 years ago. I think they call it a tuk-tuk. And then this is a little coaster that my mother-in-law and sister-in-law gave to me. It's called RV There Yet. Ha ha ha. So that stays in the camper van. And this is the back area. Oh, and that's Sapphire. That's our car. And oh, and that's my book that I wrote, and I try and give it away to the free libraries whenever I come by. And those are some hats. Oh, and there's some joy. I bought those letters at Michael's, I think, and then painted them myself. And then my most recent acquisition is actually this scarf that I just wrapped around the wire holder there, and that just holds my clothes and stuff like that. And then this is the back area where I have just some random stuff. And I'll show you how the bed goes down. Normally what I would do is sleep upstairs, and I showed the upstairs. Oh yeah, that's my Tibetan prayer flags that I got in Nepal. Normally what I do is I push the top up, which I showed in a different video, and I sleep upstairs, but because it's too cold, I put the bed down, and I'll show you how that works. Hello. Okay, this is how the bed works. First, what I do is I have to hop over here, go to the back. Luckily, I'm small. Look at this. See? And then I take my quilts and I put them aside, because you have to have lots of quilts when it's cold. Then, and this is actually a heated blanket that I bought my husband for Christmas, and then I stole it. I guess I co-opted it for the van. So I move everything out of the way because there's this big space here now. And then I hop back over and pull this. Ta-da! And then it's a big bed. And then you can sleep on the whole thing. And then usually what I have when I'm camping is my big food container here, which is when this is up, then it's behind here. And then when I sleep, there's still lots of room to sleep here, even with the big food container. So yeah, this is the camper van. To put the bed back together, you ask? Of course. All you gotta do is a piece of cake, go like this. And then what I have to do, watch this. Ah! Because I'm not strong enough. And then you just put it all back together and voila. That's me and Ruby. Sometimes this is what winter camping looks like.